must have fallen from the sky. You must have shattered in your own way. You brought so many to.
I think what people are connecting to with the film is the very homemade, down and dirty quality to it.
This film feels like a film made in your bedroom. You know, it feels like something you made one evening.
We'd never treated it like work. We treated it like a project that we really enjoyed coming back to.
Who's the lead singer in The Frames and who's obviously the lead man in Once, was putting together a band. And this is back in 1990 or 1991. And I was playing bass around in music shops. So I joined The Frames, and that became then my kind of professional. I was in a band, I was getting a wage, we were recording records and stuff. And at the same time, I kind of had this camcorder that I'd borrowed from a friend who was making films and, you know, short comic sketches. And I got bitten by filmmaking. And for me, they're quite similar, filmmaking and music making. So Once is really an attempt to kind of marry the two. You know, it's a film, but it very much speaks through the use of music and lyrics. The idea of Once, which I realized the appeal for me in a way was, I'm not going to spend a year and a half scripting this. It doesn't have to be a perfect script. It's more about tone, it's more about mood, and it's more about songs and the way people communicate through songs. So there'll be these bullets in the script that go along that are kind of just descriptive passages of how the song will work. So I ended up writing like a 60-page script, which is what we went to shoot with.
When your mind's made up, there's no point.
All John wanted every night was convincing performances. He didn't necessarily want overly passionate. I mean, he even told me to tone it down at parts, which was fair enough. There was kind of parts where, I guess, some songs I'm kind of blasting it out a bit much. And so the whole thing was just a kind of a convincing performance of the tunes.
Not too much though, Rob.
Yeah,
too much.
I've been really comfortable with the music part, even in the film, because that's something I know I'm used to. And then the acting I've never done before, I didn't even know, you know, how you do it or what do you do. So it was something completely different. And I guess the fact that it was musical made it easier for me.
I think it's like 60% of the film is actually music. That's when we're not acting at all. That's the part where there is no acting. It's just me, Glen being Glen and Mar being Mar. And so in a way, I guess that adds somewhat to the, if there is a natural feel to the film, that adds somewhat to that, because we're not acting in those bits, we're just playing.
So which is talk back is that?
Just any of these.
Yeah, okay, great. And these are your favorites, and these are your EQs, like bass, if he does want to do a little bit of EQing during the track. Yeah. That's cool.
Glen and John have been mates for a very long time. And when John was thinking of making this movie, he went to Glen to ask him to write some music for it.
He called me anyway, and we met in town, and he said to me, look, Glen, I have this idea for a film. He said, I'd really like to use a couple of your songs. There was one song in particular, Say It To Me Now, which is the song I play, the opening song.
Scratching out the surface now, I'm trying hard.
He said, I want to use that, and I want to use a couple of others, but I was wondering if maybe you'd think about writing me a few songs for the film. So I went off, I wrote him a few songs, and I came back and I handed him like a tape with four or five ideas. And he really liked them.
And it became very clear to me as I started thinking of actors, actually, you know, these songs need to be really, really good. They need to be amazing. Can't just be kind of a good actor who can half sing. Maybe I should be going for a really good singer that can half act.
Take a shot of Mar, then we're done.
Okay.
Basically, just to see this whole image of this girl with her dress and the big issues. We just never got it the last time we were here.
John kind of talked about what actors would he like to get, and he had some Irish actor in mind. and he said that he's kind of looking for the girl and he doesn't really know what to do with that.
I'd known Mar for years. And so I said to him, I said, look, I know a girl, she's Eastern European, she plays piano, and I'm sure she can act because she can do everything else fine. She's absolutely brilliant at everything she decides to do.
I met John in Glen's house during a party, actually, and I played a bit of piano for him. We chatted to him for a bit.
Myself and Mara basically played him a few songs we had written together, and he loved her.
She had this kind of otherworldliness, this kind of precociousness that you don't get with Irish girls nowadays as much. So I found that was kind of perfect for this Eastern European character. She was kind of aloof or cerebral in a way, and kind of, it was perfect.
It's like silence between lines, which is really uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And it worked, you know, because he's kind of waiting for her to say something, make a move, and she's like, I have to go. I really like that.
Then one day he just came into me in town and was like, listen, it just hit me like a, you know, something as obvious as my nose on my face that you should be this guy. And I just was like, oh God, you know. My first reaction was, you're just jumping on the nearest person. You know, you're not actually, you haven't thought about this enough, you haven't considered it. And he's like, no, he says, when I look at you and Ma are on tape and I see the way you are together, that's actually what I want in the film. I'm pointed home. We've
still got time. I just want to make a film for $100,000. I didn't want a bunch of producers with a stopwatch going, you didn't make your day. I just wanted to be left alone with Glen and Markéta, myself, Martina and David, who are the two producers who came onto set once a day to hang out and have coffee.
And one of the first things John said to me in that meeting when he introduced the project to me was, I want to do this on a micro budget. And, you know, my first reaction was like, are you mad? But, you know, it was intentional for once. Because everything then was, you know, there was no pressure. The pressure was off. We could all just become a little team making this film that nobody knew we were making. And we could just go under the wire a little bit with it and make the movie that we wanted to make.
John put together a small crew and we started shooting.
And what have I said for it? Well, it's, and I said whatever it is in Irish, because I actually don't know.
I've got a good idea. What about at the end of the scene, you say, what's the check for, do you love him?
Glen and Markéta worked with John during the filming. Glen would say, how about we try this? And Mar, how about you do this and I do this?
And you say that, and then you say no in Czech, and you don't know what that means.
And John would listen, and sometimes it worked and sometimes it didn't.
Pretty similar, like, who would have thought it, right? It's
Neh. Huh?
Director. No.
Oh, it's Neh. It's Neh. It's that simple.
Fuck!
It's Neh.
Neh.
It's nearly,
yeah. What did I think of that? We were both brilliant.
Because we know each other with Glen, we were able to improvise and kind of, you know, brush off each other, which was great and which was very comfortable and made it much easier.
Once they started to change the dialogue and change my script, actually scenes occasionally would be much, much better and much more, much more sparkle.
At the end of the dialogue I want to be, don't fucking rob off me. If you want money, just ask. And it seems like a vibe has been reached. And then he asks you for the money.
What I'd love to do is, like, what I thought was kind of amazing, that other scene was when the case dropped and you helped me put the money. I just thought that was fucking brilliant.
I have to say, there's definitely an energy about making a film that way. There's an energy about the idea that sometimes we would do a scene where John would just go like, right, we have a bit of time here, let's just do something here, just explain to her, and he would just do an ad-lib scene. And, you know, some of them we used, some of them we didn't.
Like, the important thing is getting your girlfriend back.
Yeah.
You know, maybe you get a record deal or...
I only had a record.
Just so we're guarded for that.
You go to London, you play these songs to your girlfriend, you get married, you have loads of kids, you make records.
Yeah.
You make records.
Yeah, you make records, yeah.
You know, you're going nowhere here, it's crazy, what do you think? And what's my reaction?
For me, it was harder to kind of realize how am I feeling about this person so far. We've just met, or if we kind of know each other already a bit.
My only worry is that you have to behave, you have to act as if you're a stranger and it's in your turf, so that's going to be strange.
Whereas most actors' job is to pretend that they know each other, our job was to pretend that we don't know each other.
I like learning that in the hook, and then we go, oh, the guy's fucking broken heart. And he's hiding it from her in a way.
Okay, so I'm being sound. I'm sound.
Yeah, I think you're a bit more sound.
Okay.
You take a risk with non-actors. Given the right atmosphere and circumstances, anybody can act. So for me, really, with Glen and Mar, it was really, how do I make these guys comfortable? How do I make them confident so that they're okay about reading these lines and they're not trying to act in any really big... They're really being themselves. But really, for example, the long lens decision was not an aesthetic one. It was more about... if I put a big camera in front of the Glen and Mar, you know, it would just be really awkward. It would be hard for them to do. So it was an immediate decision. What if I put the cameras miles away? So they actually can't even see them. And the you know, crowds of people are blocking and wiping the way, you know, no clapperboard, let's put the end board on it. Let's not have makeup people come in and do makeup first. Let's, you know, let's get Markéta, instead of walking from just off shot, let's send her off half a mile away up Grafton Street, ring her on her mobile, action. You know, and in 30 seconds she comes up to Glen, and this time Glen doesn't even know if we're rolling, he's bored, waiting for action. And Markéta comes up and they start to act the scene with the and suddenly it's really natural. And it worked really, really well.
You must have fallen from
here we go again.
Great. Yeah. It's Hollywood.
Why would we go again? Oh, no, I don't want to go again. I'll walk down with you. Yeah, I'm the director.
I was very comfortable with John. I could argue with him. And the funny thing is, when John was in my band, I was the guy directing him. And so it was very, very good for me and very humbling for me to be in a situation where this was his vision. And he was allowing myself and Mara to have a certain say in it, but ultimately he was the boss. And so that felt really good for me, and I really enjoyed it.
So it's kind of nice to kind of get the chance to direct him again now and kind of pay him back. For me, the songs in Once are great because it is the music, I think, that's communicating it to a wider audience. People love music in the end of the day. You can sit back, watch this couple singing to each other and playing these songs that I think, for me, watching the, you know, following the kind of the blogs online for this film, everybody seems to have taken it on a personal level. I've been there. I remember this feeling when I had this relationship.
A friend of mine said that basically what he liked about Once was that it's basically me and Mara in a bottle. And that was how he described it. He was basically, it's your friendship in a bottle. And I thought that was a very beautiful description of it. I really liked it because when I look at the film, I remember, my memories of it are all fond. It's like these great memories of me and her hanging out and doing these big long scenes, but then when we were finished, we'd go and have tea together.
I think we'll stay in touch and we'll stay in friends, we'll stay friends and everything, but I think, you know, we'll all be in a total different headspace. You know, me and Glen will probably be recording records and John will be making other films, and all we can really say to each other is, you know, fair play, that was a good time in our lives and it was really enjoyable for all of us, and, you know, I'm really happy I could have been a part of that.